week on Country Report, we meet Haggis McKenzie, a man who marches to the beat of a different drum. Stephen Boyd, a modern farm teenager, learning some traditional values through the 4-H Club. And we celebrate Oktoberfest in the Ottawa Valley.
Hello again, everyone, and welcome to Country Report. You know, if you spend a lot of time out here in the eastern part of the Ottawa Valley, you'll soon discover a large community of immigrants from Central Europe, people of Austrian, Swiss, and German descent. Now, they brought a lot of their traditions with them, but in October, there's one tradition that really comes alive, and it doesn't matter where you're from. Anybody can get into the spirit of Oktoberfest.
The Granary Restaurant is exactly halfway between Ottawa and Montreal, so it's an ideal stopping place for hungry travelers. But for one special night each year, people come from miles around just to celebrate Oktoberfest. Oktoberfest is a 175-year-old tradition that began in Bavaria. Its origins may be in Germany, but at the Granary, Oktoberfest is a truly international celebration. Swiss songs, German food, and a surprising amount of Canadian beer are the order of the day. So it's not really unusual to find an Austrian behind this cultural melting pot.
I think it's going to be really good.
Manfred Pungartnik has been in the kitchen all day, cooking up a lot of the dishes he learned to make as a boy. For tonight's festivities, he's made everything from goulash soup to cabbage strudel.
What is this here?
That is Thüringen, Austrian. But it's only a small place you can get it in Austria to begin with, you know.
And you have it here?
We have it here, yeah.
And what about this? What nationality is that dish?
Well, any you choose, that's going to be, you know.
Okay.
Let's say Turkish.
Turkish, okay. What's the potato salad?
That's Austrian.
Making Wiener Schnitzel for 90 people requires more than one cook. But this is one of the few times Manfred lets his wife Trudy into the kitchen. He calls it self-defense. Trudy calls it common sense.
You know, there is a method in that, too. If I would let anyone know that I could cook, then I would end up in the kitchen, too. So I never even tried to cook.
You intentionally cook bad?
No, I intentionally don't cook.
Well, Trudy never intended to cook. She has a PhD in art history and German languages. And Manfred was a construction engineer in Montreal before moving to Ontario 7 years ago. Now, running a restaurant may seem like a drastic career change, but Manfred doesn't think so.
I don't know. I really think somehow construction, which is my profession, is very close with cooking, you know. You put that and that and that together to get the final result, you know.
Eine gespritzten, okay.
Well, the result has become an annual Oktoberfest party at the Granary. Trudy may not spend a lot of time in the kitchen, but there's plenty to do out here. Her customers are definitely in a party mood.
They come usually to have a good time, really. It's just an excuse to have a good time. I think Oktoberfest is more popular in Canada than it is in Europe.
Mm-hmm. It's about the same, yeah. The same idea behind. What I think they get more plastered in Europe than they get here. That's maybe the difference, you know.
Now, anyone who's ever been to a real Oktoberfest knows that a hearty toast is always in order. But sometimes this custom can be just a little hard to swallow. But this is all in good fun, and most of the people who come here for Oktoberfest are used to it. A lot of them have a European background. End of harvest festivals like this are common all through Central Europe. And getting together to share that common experience brings back memories for people like Margot Schrenk.
It's a little bit of home. It makes me feel like home. Lots of beer, lots of fun, and a little bit flirting around.
But not everyone here is familiar with the Oktoberfest tradition, and some people have interesting reasons for coming tonight. Margaret Northrup is from Scotland.
Well, if you had been brought up on porridge and haggis, you would be willing to try someone else's national fare.
And how are you?
Lorna Clark came from Montreal with some friends for her first Oktoberfest.
I'm here for the good food.
How good is the food?
It's just like Mom's.
And then there were people like John Arnold, who just sort of stumbled into the whole affair.
Well, to tell the truth, I had a flat tire on the highway coming along, and I walked up to find a place, and I've now found Shangri-La.
There's an infectious spirit about Oktoberfest, and you don't have to come from Bavaria to catch it. Everyone is susceptible to that Oktoberfest feeling.
Well, you know what they say, when in Rome, do as the Romans do, but when you're at the granary, well, come dance with me, my dear little Trudy. Ottawa Winter Fair has become an annual tradition in the Ottawa Valley. And for a kid, just being part of the competition is a big thrill. Mind you, it takes more than a good-looking animal to get here. You've got to have good hands, a good heart, good health, and a good head on your shoulders. The 4-H's.
The first and second prize winners.
The 4-H Livestock Show is a big part of the Ottawa Winter Fair. It's a chance to look over some of the valley's finest beef on the hoof. And for kids like Stephen Boyd, it's a chance to show off their 4-H project. Stephen's project this year is a 1,275-pound steer, appropriately named Big Mac. Today, it's just a matter of a few final touches to impress the judges. But Stephen's real work began months ago on his family's dairy farm. The Boyd Farm is just a few miles from Ottawa. In fact, Stephen goes to a city high school, and a lot of his fellow students have no idea what the 4-H Club is all about.
They don't have the slightest idea what it is, really. Like, I'll go away a day, and I'll come back, and they ask where I was, and I say I was showing my steer at a fair or something, and they'll look at me really funny, like, what's a steer? What are you showing a steer like? And if they find out I'm walking an animal or something, they find that really different.
And if somebody's in front of you and their steer doesn't go, you should help out. It's only courtesy in the ring to help out somebody else. So give the steer ahead of you a little tap, so then you go.
The 4-H Club is a tradition on the Boyd farm. Stephen's dad, Trevor, was a 4-H member when he was a boy. Now he's a club leader, and he's happy to see his children following in his footsteps.
Being a 4-H member, your time is taken up, that slack time that they would be doing something else, maybe getting into trouble. This way it keeps them, what do they say, maybe out of trouble.
Did it keep you out of trouble?
Yeah, I think it did.
Now, modern-day farm kids have modern ways of doing their chores. Stephen is up most mornings at 6 o'clock to bring in the cows. And this Kawasaki cowboy really knows how to round them up and head them in. With all these dairy cattle available, you'd think Stephen would have chosen a Holstein for his 4-H project. Instead, he opted for a big black Chiamina Cross steer. He's a handful, but Stephen's challenge is to pull him into shape for the fall fairs.
The steers have more involved and there's more training, there's more to taking care of it than the Holsteins or the dairy. They're not much to, they're just training and that's it. There's not as much clipping and brushing and stuff. The steers are more involved. Also, the steers, you sell, at the end of the year, you sell them, whereas the dairy animals, you bring them home and you keep them.
Now, a shave and a haircut for this kind of customer can be a tricky business, but it's all part of keeping your animal well-groomed. And size is just as important as appearance. Stephen has to make sure that Big Mac puts on just the right amount of weight each day, not too much and not too little. And it all has to be carefully recorded in his 4-H project book.
There's a lot of responsibilities. It keeps you busy all day. Like, friends are going out, you know, they don't have much to do all day. And I'm busy working, you know, it's hard sometimes, but it's not that bad. I like doing them.
Getting a steer ready for the show ring takes a lot of time and patience.
Ready, stop.
But under Dad's experienced eye, this 4-H family, including Big Mac, get a good workout.
You have to walk the steer maybe even a mile, 2 miles a day to keep his muscles tight and maybe some walk off some of those pounds in his belly and put it on the muscle. He's getting better now at starting, getting him to be halter broken and to walk around for you. He sort of like walked you around instead of you walking him around.
There are 22,000 4-H members in Ontario alone, 60,000 in the whole country. Their projects can range from plant science to sowing. And besides his steer, Stephen is growing Yukon Gold potatoes. It's not as exciting as raising an animal, but at least you don't run the risk of becoming attached to your project.
2 years ago, I had a really nice steer I liked. It was a little hard to get rid of him. But, you know, the harder it is to train, the harder time they give you, the more you want to get rid of them.
How are you going to feel about Big Mac when he goes?
I don't think too bad.
Finally, it's judging day. Just to get to the Ottawa Winter Fair, Big Mac had to make a good showing at a smaller local fair. Now, he's up against the best in the valley, and Stephen knows what the judge is looking for.
They want a nice long neck, long steer, tall, nice straight legs, not hockled or turned in, or a wide rear end, like in the back there.
Good rump.
Yeah, wide rump.
I think without question, one of the strongest classes of steers that I've had to judge in terms of quality and smallness of difference from one end to the other.
The competition was tough. Big Mac came sixth out of a class of 10. But the real winners here weren't the steers. They were the 4-H'ers who worked so hard and took such pride in their accomplishments. And that's the stuff champions are made of.
It was a lot of work, but it was a good experience, and I think it was all worth it.
regular visitor to Ottawa's Byward Market, you've probably met Haggis McKenzie.
The best you ever free, without a mark, without a bow.
He's hard to miss, and if his dress code doesn't get your attention, his antics will.
Hello.
But Haggis is as lovable as he is cantankerous.
Can I give you a kiss?
You missed it, honey.
Now, you've got to wonder, where does someone like Haggis come from? The market may be his regular stomping grounds, but Haggis is actually a commuter. Haggis prefers a traditional mode of transportation, but that's the only thing about him that's traditional. It was a rainy day last spring when I tracked Haggis down finally at his home near the Ottawa River.
Haggis McKenzie.
Well, if it isn't Wayne Rothstead.
Now, when you pay Haggis a visit, you've got to be prepared for a really alternative lifestyle.
Is that your place over here?
Yeah.
Can I have a look at this?
Why not?
Look at that. What is this?
That's my old bed I put out here. Now I have my siestas here. When the sun...
It's getting all wet.
My life is governed by the weather. If it's a fine sunny day, I'm sitting on that thing. Well, I have narcolepsy, which means that I fall asleep every 4 hours, see?
So I lay down there and pop down there.
But it's
getting all wet on you out here. Look at that. Why don't you cover it with some plastic?
Why do that? Take all the fun out of the life.
Rain
won't melt you. You're not chocolate, are you? Come on.
Well, obviously a little rain doesn't bother Haggis, and neither does a little clutter. His home is a jumble of odds and ends from the local dump, but everything has a purpose.
Haggis, this guitar is getting all wet here. Why don't you... Oh, it's all broken.
Well, sure. I put it up there. It's a bird nest.
Oh, I see. Okay, another bird's nest.
Yeah, some guy sat on it.
Bird's nests everywhere, Haggis.
Now, it's hard to believe, but before he moved to the country, Haggis had a responsible government job. He was a natural history researcher. But years in a stuffy office made him yearn for a different way of life.
Freedom, dude. I'm anti-conventionist. I've been an anti-conventionist since I was 12. I do what I think is just, as long as I'm not hurting anybody. I have my own lifestyle, and if you want to live that way, fine. If you don't, it's still all right. I accept everybody's lifestyle.
There's no doubt Haggis's lifestyle goes against the grain. He's rejected a lot of modern values. For instance, the need for higher education.
You're damn right, because if you wait for a PhD in this country, you'll wait a long time for it. So I give it to myself. I'm a genius, and genius can be indicated by all the dummies who stand up and challenge me. But I'm too smart for them. I'm out of their way before they even put a hand on me.
Haggis spends a lot of time combing the beach along the Ottawa River. He looks for driftwood, or the things that most of us no longer have any use for. It's a peaceful, if solitary, life, and it leads to some homespun philosophy.
That we're not in this world to criticize anybody. We're here to help each other. And why there are lonely people around? Because they don't help other people. They're selfish. And they're dire in their money. So I tell you, go rot in your money. Money doesn't influence me at all. I'm the same person, 50 cents in my pocket is 50 bucks.
The wood Haggis finds along the beach often ends up as a breadboard or one of the dozens of walking canes that he makes to supplement his small pension. He doesn't have many needs, except for one. He loves an audience.
I can get up on stage and do Shakespeare. You want to hear some Shakespeare?
I'd love to.
All right. The quality of mercy is not strained. It droppeth as a gentle rain from heaven upon the place beneath. 'Tis twice blessed. Blesseth him that gives and him that takes. 'Tis mightiest in the mightiest.
Haggis has a repertoire that runs from sonnets to sea shanties. But his favorites are the songs that he writes himself. And he accompanies himself with his own special tom-tom.
Live each day as if for your last, and don't live in the past. We are not here to criticize, but to advise and to be a friend and love our fellow man.
Well, this kind of life may not be everyone's cup of tea, but it's enough to keep Haggis happy. And after all this singing and carrying on, what do you think happens? Well, Haggis is ready for a nap.
You're not going to sleep on me, are you, Haggis?
Well, my narcolepsy is sleeping up. It's sneaking up on me.
You figure it is?
Oh, yeah.
How much time do you figure I have with you before you're out cold?
15 minutes, 20 minutes.
And then you're gone on me?
Yeah.
For how long?
I don't know. It's up to the guy upstairs who wants me to sleep.
Well, Haggis, old pal, sleep well. Now, normal people don't always do ordinary things you'd expect them to. They can be a little strange, be a little crazy, and sometimes just downright different. You only have one kick at the can, so you leave your mark any way you can.
Bingo!
I guess that's why people do the darndest things.
It's a bobber, it's a bobber!
Baseball fever. We've certainly had our share of it this year. But this isn't the big leagues. It's the South Carlton Fastball League. And today, the Embrum Amateurs are up against MG Printing from Limoges. It's a damp day for a ball game, but there's no such thing as a rain delay here. Now, the Embrum Amateurs are like a lot of ball teams in the Ottawa Valley. That is, until the game is over. It may be a little batty, but this ball team has a bicycle built for 10.
Nice and easy.
It's the brainchild of the Embrum Amateur shortstop, Albin Menard.
Getting tired here. Got a switch.
Albin owns the local sports shop. He built the bike for a charity bicycle race last summer. The guys said it couldn't be done, but Albin has never backed down from a dare.
The guys challenged me one night, and we wanted to do something different and for our ball team, so the guy said, well, we should do a bike. So, and some of them said, well, we're not able to, you know. You're not able to, so I took up the challenge and I made it.
Fully loaded, this unique 10-speed literally weighs a ton, and the peddlers at the back have to put on the brakes for the whole team.
On Thursday, practice. For the wheels I've got on it right now, I have to put the heaviest guys in front so that the four at the back who are peddling, you know, they're not too heavy because the tires will just burst. Whoop, there's a chain. Chain just went.
It only took Albin 3 days to put his bike together. He used old bicycle parts and some tubing from construction scaffolds. And he even added a special platform to carry the team's necessities. Now, it's not surprising that this contraption draws some stares. Even the Embrum Fire Brigade stops what they're doing to watch the boys go by.
F-turn, bing-bang, what's a bump? Oh, there's a bump.
It may not be the smoothest ride in the world, and there are definitely faster ways to get around town, but Albin's invention has been such a hit with the team that next year he's planning a bicycle built for 20. So if you're thinking of signing with the Embrum Amateurs, you'd better combine your batting practice with a little peddling practice, too.
So next year, we're going to be 20 on the bike?
Yeah, the 20-seater next year. We'll bring the visiting team there with us.
Yeah. There's no doubt about it. Life is what you make it. Aren't you glad that people do the darndest thing? I guess we were all a little disappointed when the Toronto Blue Jays didn't make it to the World Series. But they'll be back again next year. As a matter of fact, so will this team. And now that I know the secret to a good season, I'm going to start practicing right now. See you later.
36, mid 37, 777 down here, 77, sir, 77, 38, 88 over there, 88, 37, 38, 37. Soul 37.
On our next program, Country Report is for the birds. The Greeley Bird Auction draws hundreds of bird breeders and bird lovers to this semi-annual event. And if you thought birds were boring, there are enough fancy feathers here to change your mind.
Four barnyard chickens.
The Greeley Bird Auction on our next Country Report.